All right, well, I guess we can get started. It's 12 o'clock by the wall clock here in my office. So we'll go ahead and get started. This is a live coding session for developing connected embedded devices using the Torizon embedded Linux system. My name is Drew Mosley. I am a solutions architect for Toradex with a long history in embedded software and embedded Linux. My focus is on developing applications with Linux devices, connected applications in the IoT space, automotive, medical, things like that. And this is our second live coding session. As I think I mentioned last time, I don't generally plan to have a lot of prepared material ahead of time. Kind of the goal of this live coding session is to really do eventually get to the point where we're actually developing some interesting things, and I kind of want the goal to be to for viewers of the channel to see everything that goes into these systems, including all the false starts and that kind of thing. So this time, this particular session is a little bit more, we're going to dive in a little bit more into some of the infrastructure components that make up the Torizon system. We started a little bit last time looking at Docker containers and that kind of thing. So we're going to go a little bit more into how the containers are used in the Torizon system and how application developers can make use of them to hopefully develop interesting applications. And we're also going to spend some time talking about OSTree, which is another one of the core infrastructure components of the system. And that's that OSTree is how we manage the base operating system and the root file system that makes up that base operating system. So one of the things I did since last time, let me bring this up here. I created a Git repository in the Toradex GitHub account. You see it here. Where I'm going to gather artifacts related to this channel and the coding sessions. All the links that I reference that are open here in this browser window are going to be in this text file. And my intent is, as we have additional episodes, we'll have additional text files, and we'll have additional subdirectories here with hopefully some shared source code that will be in various levels of functionality, so that those that want to do something similar to what we're doing can have as a starting point. So couple things, closing the loop on a couple of things from last time. There were two samples that I was playing with that I had a hard time with. One was the multi-container weather sample, and since we're talking about Docker Compose, multi-container setups, we'll get back to that later in this session. The other one I was talking about using Python code to connect to a Wi-Fi network, the setting up using the dbus API so that when you're using a containerized system, you don't necessarily have to run code in the base operating system. You can actually run code in a container and still be able to access Network Manager that's running in the base operating system. So I've actually got that here, and I've got it worked out, but I just realized I don't have my test network turned on, so give me 1 second and I will go turn on my test Wi-Fi. So which password is it for this particular? Yep, that's the right one. Resume. There it is. And one more place for me to check. Excuse me. Yep. Okay. I think we're set. So let's go ahead and we'll jump over into Visual Studio Code. I'm pretty sure that's where I was trying this before. I don't remember exactly where I got to, but I have a Python application that I created here. I'll just point out a couple of things that we had to manually change. One, we had to add a volume so that the var run dbus directory was shared with the container. This is how we access the sockets to communicate with the dbus agent. Had to set network mode host. That allows the container to see all of the host networking stack and be able to configure things. And I think those are the two. Let's see, was there anything else? Oh, yes. And then the extra packages, of course, we have to specify that we want to include Python 3-dbus, which is the dbus library bindings for Python. And then I believe everything else is automatically figured out. So if we come back here to our main.py requirements.txt, we don't really have anything in there. So this is our code. It's pretty straightforward. I pulled this, I did a Google search for Python dbus network API or something. I don't remember where I found it exactly, but it's pretty straightforward stuff. We just set up a couple Python dictionaries with all the parameters of our network. So we're starting here with an 802.11 wireless network. We provide the SSID, the interface name on the Toradex devices. The interface is going to be on MLAN 0. We have to specify that. Then we're providing the SSID here, also called live coding test infrastructure. And then we specify the pre-shared key here of my secret password. And we combine all of those bits of data into a single dictionary that we then pass into the add connection function, and the rest of this is just administrative stuff for getting connected to the system bus in the first place. So let's go ahead and jump over to my, what do I have today? I have an Apalis IMX8 board, which does have an MLAN 0. You see that it's not connected. Now, of course, the downside of doing something like this is the device has to be connected somehow to be able to deploy the code over the air. So in this case, I actually am connected to the Ethernet, which is here with this IP address. So that's how I'm getting connectivity to the board right now. But obviously, this is a bootstrapping phase to get the Wi-Fi up and running. So in this case, we'll go ahead and in fact, I'm going to go ahead and do it as a debug. So I'll set a breakpoint there, hit the F5 key, and now we'll see the Torizon IDE plugin will build everything. It will get all of the packages needed to run inside the Debian container, and it will package that up as a container, and it will ship that container over to the board, which is running here on my bench. Now, I don't have a video on it like I did last time. Everything we're doing this week is going to be at the command line, so we don't really need that extra video. So we see that it's now setting up Python, including all the dependencies for Python and Python dbus. And in a moment, we'll actually see it deploy the container over to the platform. It'll run it, and we'll be able to step through and debug. So if you're just joining us, we're kind of cleaning up a few things that we didn't get done properly last time, and then we're going to dig into more details on OSTree and Docker. I'd love to have feedback. If you guys have any thoughts or questions or ideas for future sessions, feel free. I've got the chat window open here. I try to keep an eye on it. So please, I would love to get feedback. I think that is what makes these live sessions much more interesting than just someone up here giving a presentation. So definitely want to hear from the viewers on this. Please let us know what you would like to hear in this or future episodes. So now we're deploying the image, and it's going to be running here in a moment on my board. So now we are running. And we've hit our breakpoint. So as expected with any debugger, we can step over. We see our print output. Now we'll just go ahead and run to the end, and it finishes. And if we jump back over to our login prompt in a moment, we should see an IP address. So now we're actually connected up to the Wi-Fi, and I should be able to remove the Ethernet. So I've removed the Ethernet. Let's see. Oh, and that's that also means I've lost my terminal connection to the board. So let me put that back in and we will move on. So like I said, that was just kind of bookkeeping from last time, cleaning up this ability to connect to Wi-Fi using the Python Dbus API. So I wanted to get back to that. This source code, as I mentioned, is available in our Twitch Live Coding GitHub. So within here, you should be able to edit the main.py file for your local settings, for your local SSID and password, and be able to replicate this in your local lab setups. So, dog bark with notwithstanding, we will move on. So, coming back to Torizon, the application, the architecture of Torizon is really split into two phases. I think I briefly talked about this last time, but there's really the base operating system, and then there's the application stack. The application stack, as I think we're all aware, is a container stack. Potentially running multiple containers. It's a very convenient mechanism for packaging and delivery, as well as dependency management and isolation. There's a lot of benefits that come from running your applications in a container. There is a small amount of overhead that comes at initialization time while the container runtime is getting set up. But at runtime, that overhead is pretty much minimized because any application running as a container is a standard Linux process that's scheduled by the Linux process scheduler, and is the containerization is implemented via C groups, which is standard Linux functionality, standard bits of data about a process that are in the task control block. So there's really no additional runtime overhead associated with a container system. There might be storage overhead. There is certainly some storage overhead for the metadata about the containers and that kind of thing, but Docker has a very useful layering system so that two containers that happen to use the same base system, the same base images, will reuse the storage so that you're not getting a lot of duplication if your containers happen to use the same versions of some of the components that are in them. So The other component of the Torizon architecture that I wanted to get into today is called OSTree. And most of this content that I'm presenting today comes from this paper or this blog post that I did a couple months back last June for CNX Software. So this link is in the text file that's part of that GitHub repo. I won't go through all the details of this. This blog post goes into a little bit more detail, I think, than I'll probably end up getting to in this hour-long session. But I encourage you to read through the blog post to understand it, to get more details about this. So, what is OSTree, also called libOSTree? Let's see, there's a good definition somewhere on this page. I mean, this is kind of the main definition. It combines a Git-like model for committing and downloading bootable file system trees, along with a layer for deploying them and managing the bootloader configuration. That's a lot of words, what that essentially means is it's it's a way to store multiple versions of an entire file system within a single partition. So essentially, much like Git, you'll have a repository of objects on that in that file system, and the active file system is created by creating a set of hard links between files and directories to create the appropriate directory tree. Now, I don't believe that OSTree has the concept of branching and merging that Git has. It's and we certainly don't use it that way. We actually use OSTree to provide the base operating system file system, and that is what allows us to have multiple versions, allowing us to deploy updates over the air robustly. Since it can store multiple versions in that repository, we are able to keep a known good version, install a new version, reboot into that to pick up the new kernel, and that kind of thing. And if any of the post-install checks failed, we still have the previous known good configuration that we can roll back to. So, you know, in a lot of over-the-air update systems you see for embedded Linux devices, one common method is to use the dual partition approach, where you actually have two complete redundant partitions, which gives you similar rollback capabilities at the expense of more storage space. So one advantage we get with OSTree is that if you, for files that haven't changed between one version and the next, you're just using a hard link to the same object in your repository, so you're actually deduplicating files that have not changed. So you get a little bit storage savings by using OSTree. And OSTree is carefully designed to be atomic. We've got some other blog posts, I believe. Yeah, it's this one here, which goes into some of the details within OSTree that allows it to be atomic and power safe. I won't go into those details today, but if you are interested in that, I encourage you to take a look at this. I've also given a talk about that. And we've got some other blogs and webinars about OSTree, so there's certainly lots of information out there. These are, of course, on our developer site. This is actually our new developer site that we are bringing up. It's the same content as the old site, but it's a different CMS system in the back end. At the moment, you have to manually navigate to developer-next.toradex.com if you want to see this. But this is our specific documentation on OSTree. And then this is a higher level technical overview. I'm including all of these links in the GitHub repo for this session, because this is all good background information for the things that we're getting ready to do. So let's do some command line things. So at the command line here, should be seeing my command line. Yes. Okay. So I'm going to turn off my webcam so we can do just a couple of things here. First thing to note, I'm just running right now. I'm just running OSTree natively in my Ubuntu desktop system. I'm not actually using OSTree here to store the root file system. I'm just going to do some OSTree commands just so we can kind of get a sense of what's available. First thing, obviously, just look at the help. You know, you see all the various subcommands you can invoke here. That's the first place you go to for help. And there's a man page and lots of documentation, just a Google search away. So let's go ahead and create a basic OSTree repository. So we use this command for that. And so now that has created this directory. And let's see what is in there is not. So at this point, it's created a bunch of empty directories and then this repo config file. See what's in there? Very little. So in this case, we've created a bare repository similar to a bare GitHub Git repository. So now we're going to go ahead and we're going to create some files. So we'll go into... So we'll pretend that we are doing a full root file system. So we'll create a directory called rootfs. We'll add a file to it. And now we're going to actually commit this as the first version in our repository. So, we specify repo as the directory name where the repository is stored. So this is the database of objects that are part of this individual repository. We're committing, we specify the branch name, give it a subject, and we say what files we're committing. And it spits out a nice long hash, which is an identifier of the specific commit that we just made. So now, if we cat repo, if you're familiar with Git, this should all look very familiar. So now you see that that commit hash that was shown by the OSTree commit command is now written into a text file inside the ref's head subdirectory. And we can view a little bit more data about our commit object here. So repo equals repo. Let's see, show raw. And we're going to actually show details about this commit. So I can't really do a whole lot with that, but if you are an OSTree developer, I'm sure that's very useful to you. Now, if we, let's see, can I do this? Do I have tree installed? Nope, I do not. Okay, so we'll just do find repo, not type D. So now we see all the things that were created by that individual commit. So we've got the commit object itself stored by essentially by its checksum. It also created a file object. So presumably, this is actually our file. So there's the text that's in the file. And we already looked at the ref's heads. Notice also that it creates directory trees. So this is how it's able to store metadata and the actual tree structure of the entire file system. If you want to see some information about the commit, you can see in this case we're just getting a directory listing of the commit referenced by v1, which was the version number that we put on it, and you see that it's just the single file. And one thing to note now, as I mentioned, this uses hard links to be able to deduplicate the data. So if we look at the actual file. Did I get the right one? No, I did not. Where did we decide that was? Oh, it was A5. Okay, so repo object A556, and the actual file itself. Nope, I'm still not doing something right. Oh, I know what I did. So I added the repository. I added the file to the repository, but I haven't actually checked out the repository. So all that did was update the repository. So now, if I remove my root file system and actually check out my new from my repository. So now I've got it checked out from the repository, and it has set the both of these are pointing at the same inode. So if I had multiple versions, then they would use the actual inode as a hard link to the object in the object store. So let's go ahead and create a new file. Okay, now we're going to add that. Nope, that's not what I wanted. So we will do a new commit. call it branch v2. So now we should have additional objects in our data store here. So now we have multiple directory trees. We have the new ref head as expected. If we want to take a look, we can see what the commit information was, the log information, checksums, commit IDs, that kind of thing. We can also view, you know, what are all the versions in here, which is obviously the same thing as looking at the ref's head subdirectory. And if we want to see what has changed between any two particular versions, we run the diff command, and it says, okay, we've added a file called goodbye.txt, as expected. So that kind of gives you an overview of all things OSTree. And as I said, we do use OSTree for the base operating system file storage in Torizon. So let's jump over to our Torizon board, which was the Apalis IMX8. I'm going to run as root so I don't have to type sudo every time. And let's take a look. So in this case, I don't have to specify the repo. It knows where it is automatically. In this case, you see the different references that are in there. I've only installed the one version. I think one is an alias to the other. I just did a fresh install of Torizon on my system last night. So if we deploy, and I guess we should do that, go ahead and deploy an update to this board so that we can see multiple OSTree versions getting deployed. So we'll go over here, go to our web browser, and I will log into my account on our dashboard. This is not my board, this is an old one, which has probably been reinstalled by now, so we'll go ahead and delete this board. Now we will provision our existing board into Torizon. No, nope, don't want to do it here. We want to do it on the board itself. So this will run the Torizon provisioner and connect the board up to my account on the Torizon platform. If we dismiss this, now we see that the board is here. Now, I think last time we did some Docker updates over the air. We'll go ahead and quickly do an OSTree update just so we can see something happening with OSTree. So we'll deploy an update. Now, I am running the released image. So what I will do is select the OS package. I want to go with a nightly. Let's see. We will go with Torizon Core Docker nightly and just select March 1st, that sounds good. So now we're initiating the update. Okay, so the update has been assigned to my device. I will come back over here and I'm going to restart the actualizer client so it will bypass the polling interval. And now, if we view the logs, now you see that we're downloading. So what's happening here is the OSTree is actually downloading new objects into the repository. So we are in the process of creating the new version that will eventually be loaded. So each individual object gets downloaded, and that includes all the files, all the directories, all the directory metadata that we looked at. And from there, once that's done, the system will switch over to the new version. And it will then reboot because we are doing a full update of the base operating system, which includes kernel and device tree. So obviously we will need to reboot to start the new kernel. I don't know if you saw it there at the very end. One of the things that this does is a three-way merge of files in /etc, and of course that's where all the configuration data is stored. So any configuration changes you've made that are in /etc will be maintained across updates. So for instance, the Wi-Fi setup that we did should be retained. So there's a question in the chat about getting started. There is a past session. It is available, I believe, on our YouTube. If someone with the link can post that in the chat for the user that's asking the question in the chat, that would be very helpful. There is one session prior to this where we walk through getting started with Toradex, with Torizon. And if that session is not enough, there's lots of documentation on our developer website. In fact, I will just go ahead and pull this up. In case you're not familiar with it, Toradex Quick Start. Just do a quick Google for that. So this is the easiest way to get started. This will walk you through everything from opening up the hardware when you get the brand new piece of hardware, showing you where to attach cables, where to plug everything in, and walk you through installing the operating system all the way up through deploying over-the-air updates to the system. So hopefully that answered the question. If you have specific additional questions, feel free to post them in the chat, and I'll try to address them as we go. So my board should be rebooted, so let's go back to my Torizon Apalis IMX8. And we are now logged in. See, is my Wi-Fi is indeed up and running, and let's see where we are as far as OSTree is concerned. So actually, you can see here in the command line, this is all managed by Torizon and by the OSTree system. So we tell it which OS3 revision we're using, and I believe that's actually visible here in the file system if you wanted to look into this. Horizon F9, yeah, so and then 0. So if we look there, that's actually a root file system. So this is a version of OS3, and this is actually bind mounted as our root file system. So I believe if we do this, that didn't tell me what I wanted. Let's see, yeah, there's so much other stuff in here, it makes it hard to find. But the bind mount is used to get access to the specific version. I don't believe, it does, we do maintain history across reboots. That's nice. I was unaware that we did that. So now if we look at the OSTree refs, we actually have an additional OSTree reference that wasn't in here before. So that shows that we are now running the nightly build. And I think that is probably also reflected in the OS release file. So now we're actually running a 5.6.0 nightly build, build 551, whereas we were running the 5.5 version in the previous instance of the operating system. So I think as far as OSTree is concerned, I think that's kind of the overview I wanted to give. You can actually go in and, you know, poke at OSTree within a running Torizon system if you so wish. But keep in mind that obviously you can, if you do the wrong OSTree commands, just like anything when you're dealing with low-level file system operations, you can easily bork your system. So you want to be careful with that. It's fine in an experimental system, but I certainly wouldn't manually invoke OSTree commands in a deployed system that's running in production. I would leave it to the actual Torizon core tools that are managing that. So, and just briefly, I will mention that you know, when you're doing local development using our Torizon core builder tool, which we'll get into in a future episode, it actually, Torizon core builder will connect to your device over the local area network using SSH, and it will do OSTree manipulation that way, which is a little bit different than what we just did, where we were using the OTA system, where the actualizer client running in the Linux runtime will actually download the content over the air and do the OSTree manipulations on the device. So there's really two different mechanisms, one for development time and one for production, but they end up using the OSTree infrastructure that's part of the system. So let's move on and talk about Docker containers. Now, one thing you'll notice, I am running the standard reference image with the reference containers. So if we take a look at Docker PS, you see that I'm actually running the kiosk mode browser, a Weston compositor, and the Portainer container management system. I don't have a camera set up to point at the device at the moment, but suffice it to say that if I were able to pull up a VNC viewer of it, you would see the Portainer container management system. And so, you know, obviously we've done things, I think we did, you know, last week, I think we probably did the obligatory Docker run hello world. So I don't have that image locally, so that pulled the Docker hello world image from hub.docker.com. That's the default. If you don't specify a different repository, it will by default pull from Docker Hub. Now if I run it again, it has the image locally, so it doesn't need to download it. And obviously this is hello world. It doesn't do anything terribly complicated, but you know, obviously you see that it is aware that we're running on an ARM64 system, so it pulls the appropriately tagged version of the hello world image, so that it's running the right versions of the right architecture versions. So let's see about doing some additional things. So this is where it's going to get a little bit unplanned. I've got a few things here, but you know, we might run into some issues. So the first thing you might want to do is, say you want to just run, I do this a lot when I'm experimenting, I just want to run just a standard Ubuntu or Debian. In this case, I can just copy and paste and get the Ubuntu system. The dash I specifies an interactive session, and the dash T option specifies to create a TTY for the device, which are both necessary if you are going to be running an interactive session and want to actually get access to the shell prompt in the system. So, in fact, when I was developing the Wi-Fi Connect stuff that we looked at a little bit ago, this is exactly how I did it. I ran Ubuntu in a container, and so now, if I look here, of course, I am uname still shows Torizon Core because it is sharing the kernel. But if we look in here in the OS release file, you see that we're actually running an Ubuntu, in this case 20.04.04, and so at this point, it's standard Ubuntu. I can run an apt update. I can, I can install packages. I can do whatever I would do in a desktop Ubuntu system. And so this is where I start experimenting. I try to run my Python code. Don't have Python 3. Okay, so at this point we would need to do an apt install of Python 3. And then once I get the basic Python installed, we would then start running our code, and then that's when we would find out, okay, we need Python 3-dbus. So, that's a very common working model here. Only one thing to be aware of is that any changes I make in this container environment, so if I install now, let's install the nano editor. I don't believe it's installed by default. Yep, so now we're installing nano, and if I want to run the nano editor, there we are, we're in nano. Now if I exit the Docker container, we see that there is no Docker Ubuntu container. It's still here. If I run ps-a, we see all the old containers I ran. It's got this as an automatically generated name. So we can go ahead and remove it. Now if I do my Docker run again, and I'm actually going to specify --rm so it's automatically cleaned up when I exit. Oh, I guess that has to come before. Now if I try to run nano, you'll see that nano's not here, and that's because the state in a container is not maintained automatically. That's where you would have to run into a Docker volume for storing state that you want to persist across invocations. For things like adding packages, you wouldn't use a Docker volume. You'd actually use a customized container. So let's take a look. We'll go into the Torizon samples directory that we checked out last time. Oh, it's not on my device. It's actually going to be on my desktop system. So if we go into the Torizon samples directory, and that's one of the links that'll be in the links file, you'll see we have a number of different samples of how to do things here. So let's take a look. We'll go into GStreamer. I think this one was one I wanted to look at. Simple pipeline. So you see we have a number of files here. The first one let's look at is the Docker file. So if we look at this file, so this is how you create a customized version of a container image. So this from command here is essentially an inherit. So we are actually creating this starting with the reference containers that are part of the Torizon system. And all of these variables are defined up here, or they can be defined, I believe, in a .env file. So if you need to store credentials and that kind of thing, you don't actually have to store the credentials in the Docker file. You can store it in a local file. But essentially what this does is this says, okay, I'm going to create an image, a Docker image, starting from this particular version. From this particular image. So, you know, we specify the image architecture. In our case, we're going to use ARMv7. We could specify ARM64 or whatever we needed, but it doesn't really matter a whole lot. And then there's the commands that we're going to do to customize the image. So the base image doesn't have much installed. So now we're going to go ahead and apt-get update, and then we're going to install GStreamer and a bunch of things that are needed. And then we specify the entry point, which is the command that's going to run when you invoke this container. So normally, most containers are not going to just drop you to a shell prompt and let you do things. They're actually wrapping specific functionality so that you're going to specify the entry point. And then these are the parameters that are going to be passed to that entry point. So, and then let's see. So we also then have a Docker compose file. Now, in this case, the Docker file creates an image, and the Docker compose file is setting up and defining the multiple container setup, potentially multiple container setup. So when you invoke a Docker command, right? When we were over here and ran Docker run hello world, or Docker run Ubuntu. Right, so there's a number of other commands you could pass it. So let's try just for fun. We'll say we're going to specify a volume at So what this specifies is, okay, I'm passing in a volume to the Docker container. The input to that volume is /, so that just means my home directory. And my home directory in the base operating system is passed in to the container into the path /files. So if I run this, now you see that I actually have that connect to Wi-Fi sources available from within my container as /files. If I just create a new file from within the container, and then I exit my container, now I have that file. So that's a way of getting data persistence. And so that's using volumes. So you can specify all volumes and network connectivity and all sorts of other parameters on the command line. You can run multiple Docker commands to get multiple Docker containers up and running. But Docker Compose is essentially a manifest file that allows you to specify all of those settings in a YAML file which is suitable for human viewing and storing in SCM. So rather than just writing a shell script wrapping around a bunch of Docker commands, you actually create a Docker Compose file. So let's take a look in this case at the Docker Compose ARM64 YAML file. There's a lot in here. So the first level of the tree, the YAML tree, is services. So in this case, we're actually defining multiple services. The first service is called Weston, and the second service is called Wayland. And you see that we're specifying all sorts of other parameters about each of the services. I've got in our links somewhere, I have right here. docs.docker.com. This will give you lots of information about Docker Compose and this format and all the various things that you can specify in here. So the first thing you need to specify for any given service, obviously, is what image you want to run. So this could be the Hello World, this could be the customized image that we created with a Docker file, whatever you might need. Environment variables, running the NXP Vivante graphics drivers requires acceptance of a license agreement, which you specify by setting this environment variable. Network mode host, I mentioned that previously when we were looking at the Python code, so you can also specify all your network settings here. In this case, Weston is just getting access to the entire network. Volumes, very very much like what we just specified on the command line. In this case, we're actually just passing in the entire device tree and the entire /temp subdirectory. We're adding kernel capabilities. And you don't need to know all of these specifics for some of these. You know, this Weston one is obviously significantly more complicated than any in your normal container, because it does need access to all these capabilities and C groups and things to be able to get access to an actual display device. And then there's some other things that we can put in here. There's some health checking that we can do for each individual service and that kind of thing. And then, of course, we have our second container here, Wayland, which depends on Weston, and depends on Weston being healthy, obviously. And in this case, it would be using the GST example from my namespace on Docker Hub. So let's take a look. I think if we just go ahead and build this, specifying the tag in my namespace, and we just say specify from this directory. So now we're actually building the custom Docker image. This is invoking those commands that we looked at a few minutes ago that are in that Docker file. So now it's installing GStreamer and all the dependencies. And once this gets done, we will actually have a Docker image here, which we can then run using Docker Compose on our target. So it'll take a few minutes because it's got to install all the packages and all the dependencies. But I think for most of these, they're not too bad. while this is going on, anybody got any questions or thoughts they want to share? Looks like we got about 15 people viewing right now. That's good. I like it. Well, while that's going, let me jump back over here also just to recall that we have these three containers up and running as our reference containers. And as you might expect, those are run by a Docker Compose file. And within the Torizon system, the Docker Compose file is stored in the var sota storage Docker Compose directory. So here's the Docker Compose file for the reference containers. So as you might expect, there's a service for the kiosk, which is the kiosk mode browser. There's a service for Portainer, and there's a service for Weston. And again, this looks very much like what we just looked at with some of these capabilities, C groups, and that kind of thing. If we want to stop this, so now we say Docker, if just for fun, while the others are building, if we want to stop our containers, Docker Compose, specify the full path to the Docker Compose file. And we specify the namespace of Torizon. So now you see that it's stopping all the containers. So now we have no containers running. So this is what Torizon does essentially in the background for you when you're deploying an application stack, is that it's using the Docker Compose pointing at this particular file and in the Torizon namespace to actually run the containers. You see that means that each of the containers is going to be prepended with the Torizon underscore text. So now our Docker file has, or our Docker image has finished. So if we look at Docker images, now we have this Drew Mosley GST example repository with tag latest. And if we push, and this may require my password, I don't know if I've logged in here or not. Nope, I guess I have. Oh, nope. Let's log in. Jeez. Okay, so now. Okay, so now I've logged in and I can push. So that Docker image that I just created, I'm actually pushing it out to the Docker Hub, which is a repository that's available over the internet. This will take a few minutes to upload, and then I'll actually be able to run them on my target. Okay, so now we've got that image up there. So now, I don't think I built this for 64-bit. So let's just copy that file. Okay, so now we copied the file over to here. So as user Torizon, now I have that Docker Compose file. So if I just run it with the up command, it actually will start the Docker containers and run them all in the foreground. So any logging information that comes out, any text logs from any of the containers will show up in our terminal here, and we actually don't return to a shell prompt. We'll go ahead and do that this way for the first invocation of this. Honestly, I'm not sure what's going to happen when this runs. I have not yet run this particular example. It's GStreamer, so it's probably going to display something on the screen, which is turned off, so I won't see it. But that's not the point here. We just really wanted to be able to see how to invoke the use Docker Compose to do this. Nope, and I need to modify this. Let's see, Torizon Weston, Wayland, okay, image, Mosley, GST, example. So now we're specifying that image that we just uploaded. And it won't need to re-download Weston, fortunately. It will download the GST example that we just built. Okay, so now it's downloaded all the images and it's creating the services that are specified in our Docker Compose file. Let's see. Okay, so dev video 2 doesn't exist on this particular board, so this is not quite configured properly. It's probably running the ARM32 version, since that's the Docker Compose file I used, where getting access to the hardware and that kind of thing very much requires the ARM64-bit version. But anyhow, as I said, I wanted the goal here is to be able to see all the false starts and things that happen, so I'm not going to take the time to rerun this container under 64-bit mode, but you know, these are the kind of issues you would have. So with that, I think that's kind of that covers all the material I wanted to get to today. Like I said, I will share all these links. This is another one. This is that weather app that I played with last time, but I was unable to get it to work. But I went back through it. You'll have to go set up, get your own API key at openweathermap.org. It's not hard to do. Just create an account and create a free API key, and then you modify the sources and just run them. The last thing I want to show before we call it a weekend is, so we've done an update already today with OSTree to update the base operating system. But if we want to deploy an update of an application package, you see here that it actually says Docker Compose. So when you are creating in the Torizon platform an application package, what you're actually uploading is just that Docker Compose file. So the images themselves are stored in the Docker repository, in the Docker Hub, or whatever Docker repository you have. I'm not sure. Yeah, so I do have a stock YAML file here. So this is essentially the YAML file that sets up that portainer stack. So when you're actually doing over-the-air deployments of containers, of application stacks, you are actually downloading through the actualizer system. We'll download the Docker Compose file, and then it will essentially do Docker Compose down on the existing application stack and Docker Compose up on the new application stack. So I'm not going to bother to do that now because this is essentially what's already there. When you're developing your own applications, you're going to have your own YAML file with whatever settings are appropriate for your particular application. Multiple services, very common to have a web front end of some kind in one service, a web server in another service, and a database in a third. That's a very common architecture where you could use Docker Compose to be able to specify that multiple service setup with all the connections between them, specifying network access and file access and things like that. So with that, I'm going to hang out for a few more minutes in case there are any last questions, but we are up at the end of the hour here. So, for those that it's getting close to the end of the day, I will wish you a good weekend. For those who still have to work for a few hours like me, have a good rest of your day, and then everybody have a nice weekend. Like I say, I'll stick around for a few minutes in case there are any questions, but the chat has been pretty quiet, so I'm guessing there's not a whole lot. And if you do have any thoughts and you want to send email to us afterwards, feel free to reach out to us through our community website or any of our other contact information. I'm at Drew Mosley on Twitter, and you can also, I'll type my email address here in the chat. You can email me directly if you have thoughts on how we can make this live coding session better for future episodes. Thank you very much.